dear students, I welcome you on the lecture series of auditing. Under today's lecture, we shall take up unit 1 and we will discuss in detail about the meaning and objective of auditing. In our previous lecture, which was the introductory lecture of auditing, we have discussed in detail the meaning of auditing and various type of audits being conducted. We have broadly classified the audits in 2 phases, internal audit and external audit. Today, continuing our discussion on the introductory part, we shall discuss about meaning and objective of auditing. So, today's objective of the lecture is to analyze and detect various type of fraud, because detection of fraud is also one of the important objective of the audit. Though it's not the primary objective, as we know that primary objective of audit is to give the true and fair opinion about the financial statements of any business entity. However, its secondary objective is to detect any fraud or error which is being traced out while conducting the audit. So, we should have a knowledge about the frauds, what are the types of frauds and how they are being detected. Secondly, we will discuss the basic principles governing an audit. They are the pillars on which the audit is being made, or where the audit is being conducted, such principles are to be adhered to by any auditor. Then, understanding the objective of audit, scope of audit, and lastly, we will discuss the inherent limitation of an audit. So, we will start up the first topic of discussion, that is fraud. We have already discussed its meaning. So, let us revise the definition. Fraud is an intentional act which includes willful misrepresentation, the deliberate concealment of material fact, or the failure to disclose material fact for the purpose of inducing another person or putting him at a disadvantage. So, we will continue various types of frauds in this lecture. We have already discussed misappropriation of cash. So, the second aspect we are discussing in this lecture, and that is misappropriation of goods. Chances of such frauds are greater in case goods which are less bulky but more valuable, because it is easy to misappropriate such items. Now, how shall we detect them? By proper maintenance of accounts, by regular stock taking, and by maintaining a periodic and strict check on incoming and outgoing goods. So, in all, we have to ensure that proper quantity is being taken care of. There should be proper stock records, proper maintenance of the various registers which will tell us the incoming goods and outgoing goods details. Then another type of fraud is known as steaming and lading. Let us understand what this phrase exactly means. According to the method of steaming and lading, money received from customer may be pocketed, and when money is received from other customer, that may be shown as being received from the former customer and so on. If we take up an example, we have received rupees 1000 from Mr. A, but we have not shown it and pocketed it. Now, certain money is being received from Mr. B, so it will be said that Mr. A has given that particular money which Mr. B has given, and we will make up such chain so that there can be teaming and lading, and the original amount cannot be detected, and there can be misappropriation of cash by using the technique called teaming and lading. Now, next one is manipulation and falsification of accounts. Some methods of manipulating the accounts are as follows. First one is omitting to record various expenses. That means we have not recorded the expenses which are being incurred. Then recording fictitious sales or purchases. Thirdly, creating or utilizing the secret reserves. So, these are the methods by which the falsification of accounts can be made, and fraud can be committed either at the lower level or at a higher level, depending upon the materiality of the fraud. Now, the next one is window dressing. It implies the practice of arranging the disposition of assets and liabilities in such a way that affairs of the business as shown in the balance sheet does not show the normal financial position. It may represent the affairs of the business more favorable than actual. It can be done in the following ways. Goods in transit are shown as actual sales. So, the sales figures would be reflected on a higher side. Resultantly, the profit would be reflected on a higher side, and it will give the investor or the user of the financial statement impression that business is going well. B is recording of sales and income of the following year in the current year. That means if sales has taken place in the next year, but we have recorded it in the current year so that the current balance sheet is reflected at a higher end. What happens that where such information is being used either by a banker or an investor, he will get this, he will be deceived and he may take a decision which will be disadvantageous to his own organization or to himself. Now, let us discuss another aspect, that is aspects to be generally covered in audit. So, let us understand what are the peculiar aspects which should be touched in an audit. First one is examination of the system of accounting and internal control. So, here there are two aspects. First one is accounting is to be analyzed and secondly the internal control. Internal control is a much broader term. When we will take up this topic internal control, we can enumerate our discussion on it, but right now let us understand how we will examine the internal control. Internal control means that how procedures are being inbuilt in a organization so that correct flow of the work is being done. That means there should be one data operator, that means one person is doing the input of the data, other is analyzing the data, and recording of the data and analysis of the data is being done separately. There should be proper flow of controls at each and every place in an organization so that labor can work efficiently. There should be less chances of fraud and errors. So that's what we call internal control. B is review the system and procedure in place. C, checking the arithmetical accuracy of books of account, that's very obvious when audit is being done. Verification of the authenticity and validity of transaction, that's what we call that to find out the audit evidences, whether the transaction is being recorded is genuine or not. For that, we can take up the debtor's confirmation, creditor's confirmation, bank confirmations and various details from the third party so as to ensure that transaction is being authenticated and a valid one. E is verification and classification of items into capital and revenue properly. That's the part of the auditor to analyze that whether transactions are being recorded in their true terms. That means if there is a capital expenditure like acquisition of asset, same should be recorded as asset rather than expenditure, and balance sheet should show a proper picture. So, we should analyze very properly and in detail all the accounting principles and accounting policies which are being adhered to by the organization or not. Next one is comparing balance sheet and statements of profit. We have to compare the balance sheet, that is the opening balances and closing balances are to be verified with the last year data as well as subsidiary books and various analyses such as cash flow statements and various other helping statements should be confirmed. We should give weightage to the MIS reports. Then verification of title, existence and value of asset. It is related to the valuation and audit of the fixed asset. So, there we are going to value or verify the title, that means the business assets are being recorded in the business, it should be in the name of the business, they should be in existence. So, physical verification of the asset should be done so that we can analyze whether there is no fictitious asset in place. There should be proper billing of the asset, there should be a proper billing of the asset and it should be in place in the organization. Next one is checking the results of operations of business. That's what we call that profitability is being analyzed. Then verification of liabilities, which can be done by taking the creditor's confirmation and doing a detailed analysis of the business data. Then reporting to the appropriate person or body. That means we should report to the person who has appointed the auditor, or if it is a statutory auditor, proper audit report is to be given. So the appropriate person should again be reported for all the audit procedure which is being done, and finally what conclusions are being drawn up. Now coming to the next topic, which is very crucial when any audit is being conducted, that is to adhere to the principles which are being governing or which are being suggested by the regulating bodies. So there is a SA called SA 200. Now it has been revised. So under SA 200 old, there were certain principles which were being given so that audit can be conducted on these pillars. So let us understand what are these basic principles governing an audit. The first one is integrity, objective and independence. The terms used are integrity, that's given the foremost importance. Integrity means rationality of the person, and it shows its own. The first term used is called integrity. By integrity we mean that how honest, how sincere the auditor is. Objectivity is a term which will denote how objective, how rational is a auditor. Is he unbiased or not? Then independence. Independence means he should not be governed by any person. There should not be influence of any person on his reporting. He should be fair in his deal. So let us understand what is being given under integrity, objective and independence. The auditor should be straightforward, honest and sincere in his professional work. He should maintain an impartial attitude. So that's the gist of the first principle being given, that is integrity, objective and independence. The second one is confidentiality. By confidentiality, it means that information should be furnished only when it is required under any statute or for any professional reference. So let us understand what is being given under confidentiality. The auditor should not disclose any information acquired in the course of his work to a third party without specific authority or unless there is a legal or professional duty to disclose. Taking up an example, if financial position or financial statements are being required by any income tax authority of any person or entity, under that scenario auditor is required to give such information. Unless to any unrelated third party, such information should not be given. The third one is skill and competence. The audit should be performed and the report should be prepared with due professional care by persons who have adequate training, experience and competence. So here again very important terms are being used where we are talking about skills and competence. When we say skills, it is called the way it is being conducted, that how the reports are being prepared. They should be prepared with due professional care where all the legal provisions are being complied with. And competencies, they should have the training experience and competence. They should be eligible auditors who are required to conduct such audit. The fourth one is work performed by others. There is a separate essay on work performed by others. Let us understand what do we mean by it. When the auditor delegate work to assistants or use the work performed by other auditors and experts, he continues to be responsible for expressing an opinion. So here we want to say that even if the work is being delegated to the assistant or the lower authorities, again the person responsible will be the one who is signing audit report, who is conducting this audit. So he cannot put up the responsibility as to the truth and fairness of the financial reports for which he is responsible on other's shoulder. Similarly, if the work performed by other auditors are being used, then also auditor should ensure that it is complete in all terms. For example, if a statutory auditor is conducting an audit and he is relying on the internal auditor's report, again he should check the internal controls which are in place and should continue doing the audit as per the parameters being given to him. Fifth one is documentation. The auditor should document matters which are important in providing evidences. So, he should document important agreements, important data which helps him to prove his worth, that he has done the work and there is proper documentation or filing of the work which is being done by him. For example, in conducting a bank audit, the important data as to the stock audits being conducted can be accumulated for the official references, or any such data which reflects that the transactions on the specific dates as being audited or not. So, such details should be documented, should be properly filed. So, that is the purpose of doing documentation, where auditor can give importance of his work, or the auditor can show that the particular work is being conducted by him. Then comes the planning. The auditor should plan his work to enable him to conduct an effective audit in an efficient and timely manner. Plan should be based on knowledge of the client's business. So, generally what happens that an audit plan is being drafted, and step by step each aspect, that is both financial aspect as well as legal aspect and the internal control aspect, is being taken care of. So, when an audit is being performed, both substantive and compliance tests are being done, and wherever possible the sampling is also being done. So, it is the planning of the auditor. Depending upon the client's business, he plans such audit plan so that effective audit can be conducted. An effective audit plan is being made so that there is no escapement of any material information while conducting the audit. The next one is audit evidence. The auditor should obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence through the performance of compliance and substantive procedure to enable him to draw a reasonable conclusion. Here again the big important terms are being used, which are known as compliance and substantive procedure. They are nothing but simply the test of the financial data as well as the internal control. So, both the things should be taken care of so that proper and sufficient audit evidences can be collected so that an auditor can draw up a proper conclusion. Next one is accounting system and internal control. The auditor should gain an understanding of the accounting system and related controls and should study and evaluate the operation of internal control upon which he wishes to rely in determining the nature, timing and extent of the other audit procedures. So, here a question comes into the mind of the students that why there is need to analyze the accounting system and internal control, because once it is being analyzed that there are proper control checks, there is a proper procedure of accounting as well as the checks, what happens that the nature, timing and extent of the audit can be determined. If the internal controls are weak, the checking procedures would enhance and accounting system would be evaluated in detail. However, if the internal controls are strong and there is a proper accounting system which is being understood by the auditor, he can restrict the audit checkings and procedures can be minimized so as to complete the audit in time. The last one is audit conclusions and reporting. The auditor should review and assess the conclusion drawn from the audit evidences obtained and from the knowledge of the business entity as the basis for expression of his opinion. So, lastly, when an audit is being conducted, auditor is required to give this opinion or expression to the reporting authority. He is not supposed to keep it with himself. So, the conclusions are being drawn and such reporting or expression of opinion is to be done. Now, students, we are going to discuss another important aspect, that is scope of audit. Scope of audit means the area of audit, how far and how long we have to go in an audit. So, the scope of audit of financial statements will be determined by the auditor with having regard to terms of engagement, the requirement of the relevant legislation and the pronouncements of the institute. So, these three are the governing factors which will decide the scope of audit. First one is the term of engagement. That means whatever has been given in the appointment letter, auditor has to abide by it. Then the relevant laws as well as the pronouncements of the Institute of Chartered Accountant of India has to be taken care of while conducting an audit. Wherever there is a statutory requirement to conduct an audit on certain parameter, it cannot be restricted by the terms of engagement. So, legislations and the pronouncements would be given a weightage over the terms of engagement. However, an auditor cannot exceed its authority over the terms of engagement. If an auditor is being appointed to do the statutory auditors, he has to restrict his work only up to the statutory audit rather than going for any other aspect of audit. Now, we are ending up our lecture of today. In today's lecture, we have learned in detail about various sort of frauds which are being detected while conducting an audit. We have also learned certain important parameters which are to be taken care of while conducting an audit. And we have discussed SA 200 which suggests us that how basic principles governing an audit are to be adhered to while conducting the audit. So, overall we have learned about the compliance as well as substantive procedures to be carried out so that the opinion or expression on the true and fair view of the financial statements can be expressed. With this, we are ending up our lecture of today. Thank you.